This all came about when yesterday I was just going to YouTube. I like to listen to testimonials and sermons and songs and stuff. And I just saw this most anointed preachers of all times or something like that pop up and started listening to it. And it was old time preachers, just audio with the captions were on so you could understand them. But anyway, in the middle of it, it was just like, I just started weeping in the spirit, and it was like, wow, just revelation knowledge of, I felt like I am so far from what God wants me to be and to where I am, and it was just revelation knowledge. And I'm sharing with my husband, let him listen to it, and he felt the same passion. So we thought that was the inspiration to this. So I hope you feel that same revelation that we did, and it's really about our God is worthy. And so I'm just going to ask that we just really listen humbly and take it to our heart. It's so easy to listen to something and say, oh, that's really good. I hope my daughter's listening, or I hope my husband's listening, or I hope my wife's listening. But let's really think about us and how we can just humbly receive this message. And so it is for you, it is for me. And I just ask, Father, that your Holy Spirit would be here and that you would get all the honor and all the glory, and that as we just humbly are vessels of you, for your purpose, Lord, that you would use us, that you might get all glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Our God is worthy. Why is he worthy? Worthy of what, and why is he worthy? Jeremiah 32:17, and I don't know how well you can see this, but feel free to jot these scriptures down and go back later. Ah, sovereign Lord, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. Nothing is too hard for you. If that wasn't enough, it tells us why he is worthy. He made the heavens and the earth by his great power. He is worthy, isn't he? Isaiah 40:28-29 says, do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary. His understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. He's our source of strength. He's our source of power. He's our source of understanding. He is worthy. Why is he worthy? Because he is sovereign. Sovereign means all supreme. All supreme. He is all powerful. Omnipotent. Omni means all. Omni means all. So he is all powerful. He is all knowing, omniscient, all knowing, all wise, all understanding, all. He is omnipresent. He is all present. He is everywhere. And David said, such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. Is he worthy? Why is he worthy? He's eternal. Our God is eternal. He has always been, and he always will be. Why do we ever think we are anything? Our life is but a vapor. compared to an eternal God. He is eternal. He said in Revelation 1:8, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, which is, which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. He is worthy. He's unchanging. I am the Lord, I change not. Malachi 3:6. Hebrews 13:8 says, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Are we changing? What mood are we in today? What's our new belief today? What values do we hold to today? We're shifting, we're changing. What is the social culture? What's the new trend? We're constantly changing, but our God never changes. Is he worthy? Amen. He is worthy because he is love. God is love. That's who he is. He is worthy because he is holy. He's complete, not lacking anything. He is sinless. He can't sin if he wanted to. He is sinless. He is pure. Not one impure part of God. Is that not a cause enough for him to be worthy? He is sinless. We can't even compare to him. He is just. In this world of injustice, he is just. In all his ways, he is just. Do you know every time we question his goodness, every time we say life isn't fair, every time we say, why is God doing this to me? Why doesn't he let me have this? Why do they have it better than I do? Every time we complain and every time we gripe and every time we get offended, we're questioning the justice and the goodness of our God. Is he worthy? He's worthy. He's worthy because he's righteous in all that he does. In all that he does, he is right. Don't we question sometimes his goodness? Don't we question his justice and his righteousness? How could all those people be suffering? Is God really good? Is he really just? Why did I go through that tragedy? Why did my loved one go through that? And we question God. But he is worthy because he is all righteous. It shows us where our minds and really where we are. We're not even in the ball game. We're not. We don't even have a clue how good, how righteous, how worthy he is. He's merciful. Every good thing that we have in our life is because of his grace and his mercy. He's gracious. Anything good that we've accomplished, anything good that comes out from us, anything good in our life, and we're surrounded by good, is because of him. We can't take 1 ounce of credit. Those pats on the back that we all look for and we all like and sometimes want to, well, I did that, so, you know, and God used me, and, you know, even our in our humility and even sometimes in our praise to God, we're like, hey, look at me. God's using me. Whew. We're not even worthy. Don't clap for me. Don't say good lesson. Give God all the praise because anything good comes from him. We should all just be laying out here in total humility and repentance. That's where our hearts should be at all times because we are so unworthy and he is so worthy. He's compassionate. He's so compassionate that he would even reveal any bit of this truth to us, that he would put a seed of faith in us, that he would let us trust his son and know his son. That's compassion. Undeserved compassion. He's mighty. We talked about his sovereignty. And he's the creator of all. James 1:17 reminds us that every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. Nothing evil comes from God. It's good. If it seems evil to us, it's still good because it's from Him. He turns all things, remember, to our good, to those who love Him, who are called. Every good and perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness. He doesn't change. He doesn't pick and choose when He's going to be good to this one and bad to that one. He is unchanging, no variables, neither shadow of turning, not even a flicker of change with our God. And everything good is from His hand. Is He worthy? It's all about Him. It is all about Him. This life is all about Him. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. It's not about us. Amen. It's not about us. Humanism, and this is what was the trigger when I just started weeping. It's like humanism. Oh yeah, that's those people who think they don't need God. The actual definition is there, a doctrine, attitude, or way of life centered on human interests or values, especially a philosophy that usually rejects supernaturalism. Is our God a supernatural God? So humanists usually reject Him and stress an individual's dignity and worth and capacity of self-realization through reason. Self-realization being fulfilling our greatest potential. Humanism says it's all about you. That's the fifth grade level of definition for humanism. It's all about you. Pretty much opposite of what the word says. It's all about you and your happiness. And you know what? We see the world looking and seeking after things that will make them happy. Let me get another degree. Let me get a higher position. Let me get a better paycheck. Let me get a bigger house. Let me get a nicer car. Let me wear nicer clothes. Let me Me. Let me get another relationship. Let me go to another church. It's all about me, isn't it? And how has that infiltrated the Church of Jesus Christ? And how has that infiltrated my life? How has that infiltrated your life? When we don't even realize that much of what we seek after, the love, the attention, the approval of others, is self-seeking behavior, and it is not about God. We have made this, even religion, we have made it about us. Oh, God wants you well. God wants you healed. God wants you famous. God wants you rich. God wants... Is that what He wants? No, He wants to be glorified in us. He wants to be glorified through us. We are vessels for His glory. It isn't about you. It isn't about me. Pride says it's all about you. Materialism says it's all about you. Give me more stuff. Give me more things. Selfish ambition says it's all about you. I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that, and I'm going to get here, and I'm going to get there. It's like, is that God's will? Have you even considered His will? How many times do we plan out our life, and it's like we've never even consulted God? We've never said, Lord, Your will be done. Even Jesus was subject to the Father's will. Remember that? He said, I can't do anything apart from the will of my Father. The world says it's all about you. They'll say that plain out. It's all about you. Pamper yourself. You're worth it. Religion says it's all about you. Come to church, you'll feel good. Come to church, God will give you peace. God will give you this. God will do that. Those things are a byproduct, but they aren't why we're here. Your actions and attitude says it's all about me. You offended me. You said something that hurt my feelings. You did something that really irked me. That's all about me. Boy, is this not convicting? It's convicting me. It's all about him, for he is worthy. Our only purpose, if we could get this right, everything in our life would make sense. All the confusion would be gone. All the insecurities would be gone. All the offenses would be gone. All the wandering here and there and all this would be gone because we would see our one purpose, our only purpose is to bring our God glory, our God who is worthy. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible. Whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. That in everything, he might have the supremacy. Colossians 1, 16 and 18. He is worthy, as Revelations reminds us, and someday, and there are currently angels assigned to constantly before the throne of God saying, say it with me, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. He's worthy of what? He's worthy of our praise. There is no room for griping in the Christian's life, because the moment you gripe, you're taking the glory from God. Every time you complain, you're saying, this is about me. He's worthy of our love. That's all he's asked us. He said, would you just love me? It's my first and greatest commandment. Love me. With all your heart, love me. You'll see some things and hear some things on the video that we're going to play, but just to reinforce it, this one preacher says, if you are to love God as he's commanded, that means, and if you want to be the bride of Christ as he's called us to be, you must divorce the world completely, completely. That's the entertainment, that's the materialism, that's the selfish ambition, that's the humanism. He's worthy of our love. If we love anything more than God, it is an idol to us, and he is dishonored. We're making it about us. He's worthy of our obedience. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. He is worthy. And why are his commandments there? They are there for our protection, aren't they? They are there for his glory. He is worthy of our very lives. Do we get up every morning and said, Lord, not my will, but thine be done? Do we? And really mean it? No, we have our to-do list already planned out. We already know what we're going to do, and we don't even consult God. Father, lead my footsteps today. Bring someone in my path today. Help me to love you more today. Help me to trust you with everything I encounter today. Let you get the glory for this day. Amen. All right, we're going to start a video, and it's going to be 15 to 20 minutes, and it's audio, but it does have the subtitles so you can read it because it's a little muffled. These are old-time ministers, and I honestly don't recognize a lot of the names, but I hope that it will get us where we need to be and put God on the throne where he belongs in our own lives.
Is the happiness of man. So it wasn't long until we had this. The fundamentalists knew each other because they said, we believe these things. They were men, for the most part, that had met God. But you see, it wasn't long until, having said these are the things that establish us as fundamentalists, the second generation said, this is how we become a fundamentalist. Believe in the inspiration of the Bible. Believe in the deity of Christ. Believe in his death, burial, and resurrection. And thereby become a fundamentalist. And so it wasn't long until it got to our generation where the whole plan of salvation was to give intellectual assent to a few statements of doctrine. And a person was considered a Christian because he could say uh-huh at four or five places that he was asked to. And if he knew where to say uh-huh, someone would pat him on the back, shake his hand, smile broadly, and say, brother, you're saved.
At what cost?
And so it had gotten down to the place where salvation was nothing more than an assent to a scheme or a formula. And the end of this salvation was the happiness of man, because humanism has penetrated. And so if you were to analyze fundamentalism in contrast to liberalism of 100 years ago as it developed, it'd be like this. The liberal says the end of religion is to make man happy while he's alive. And the fundamentalist says the end of religion is to make man happy when he dies.
We're still paddling on the edge of the ocean of the possibilities of grace, but a holy dissatisfaction in us tonight.
Until we find it something like this. Accept Jesus so you can go to heaven. You don't want to go to that old, filthy, nasty, burning hell when there's a beautiful heaven up there. Now come to Jesus so that you can go to heaven. And the appeal could be as much to selfishness as a couple of men sitting in a coffee shop deciding they're going to rob a bank to get something for nothing. It becomes so subtle that it goes everywhere. What is it? In essence, it's this. That this philosophical postulate that the end of all being is the happiness of man has been sort of covered over with evangelical terms and biblical doctrine. Until God reigns in heaven for the happiness of man, Jesus Christ was incarnate for the happiness of man, all the angels exist and everything is for the happiness of man. And I submit to you that this is unchristian. Christianity says, the end of all being is the glory. Humanism says the end of all being is the happiness of man. This is the betrayal of the ages. And it's the betrayal in which we live, and I don't see how God can revive it. Until we come back to Christianity. Isn't man happy? Didn't God intend to make man happy? But as a byproduct, and not a prime product. Now I ask you, what is the philosophy of mission? What is the philosophy of evangelism? What is the philosophy of a Christian? If you'll ask me why I went to Africa, I'll tell you I went primarily to improve on the justice of God. I didn't think it was right for anybody to go to hell without a chance to be saved. And so I went to give poor sinners a chance to go to heaven. Now, I hadn't put it in so many words, but if you'll analyze what I've just told you, do you know what it is? It's humanism. That I was simply using the provisions of Jesus Christ as a means to improve upon human conditions of suffering and misery. And when I got to Africa, I discovered that they weren't poor, ignorant little heathen running around in the woods looking for someone to tell them how to go to heaven. That they were monsters of iniquity. They were living in utter and total defiance of far more knowledge of God than I ever dreamed they had. They deserved hell because they utterly refused to walk in the light of their conscience and the light of the law written upon their heart, and the testimony of nature, and the truth they knew. And when I found that out, I assure you, I was so angry with God that one occasion in prayer, I told him that it was a mighty little thing he'd done, sending me out there to reach these people that were waiting to be told how to go to heaven. When I got there, I found out they knew about heaven, didn't want to go there. And that they were loved their sin and wanted to stay in it. I went out there motivated by humanism. I'd seen pictures of lepers. I'd seen pictures of ulcers. I'd seen pictures of native funerals. And I didn't want my fellow human beings to suffer in hell eternally after such a miserable existence on earth. But it was there in Africa that God began to tear through the overlay of this humanism. And it was that day in my bedroom with the door locked that I wrestled with God. For here was I coming to grips with the fact that the people that I thought were ignorant and wanted to know how to go to heaven and were saying, someone come and teach us, actually didn't want to take time to talk with me or anybody else. They had no interest in the Bible and no interest in Christ. And they loved their sin and wanted to continue in it. And I was to the place at that time where I felt the whole thing was a sham and a mockery, and I'd been told a bill of goods. And I wanted to come home. And there alone in my bedroom, as I faced God honestly with what my heart felt, it seemed to me I heard him say, yes, will not the judge of all the earth do right? The heathen are lost. And they're going to go to hell, not because they haven't heard the gospel. They're going to go to hell because they are sinners who love their sin. And because they deserve hell. But I didn't send you out there for them. I didn't send you out there for their sake. And I heard as clearly as I've ever heard, though it wasn't with physical voice, but it was the echo of truth of the ages finding its way into an open heart. I heard God say to my heart that day something like this. I didn't send you to Africa for the sake of the heathen. I sent you to Africa for my sake. They deserve hell, but I love them. And I endured the agonies of hell for them. I didn't send you out there for them. I sent you out there for me. Do I not deserve the reward of my suffering? Don't I deserve those for whom I died? And it reversed it all, it changed it all, it righted it all. And I wasn't any longer working for Micah in 10 shekels and a shire, but I was serving the living God.
The more longer I live, the more I find I don't know. 2 years ago, God gave me a word for the new year. I don't go scattering through the book to find one. The Lord gave me a word, rejection. Great.
Why did you repent? I'd like to see some people repent on biblical terms again. You see the difference? You see the difference? The difference is here's somebody trembling because he's going to be hurt in hell. And he has no sense of the enormity of his guilt, and no sense of the enormity of his crime, and no sense of his insult against deity. He's only trembling because his skin is about to be singed. And this is the difference between 20th century preaching and the preaching of John Wesley. Wesley was a preacher of righteousness that exalted the holiness of God. And when he would stand there with the 2 to 3 hour sermons that he was accustomed to deliver in the open air, and he would exalt the holiness of God and the law of God and the righteousness of God and the justice of God and the wisdom of his requirements and the justice of his wrath and his anger, and then he would turn to sinners and tell them of the enormity of their crimes and their open rebellion and the treason and their anarchy, the power of God would so descend upon the company that on one occasion it is reliably reported that when the people dispersed, there were 1,800 people lying on the ground, utterly unconscious. Because they'd had a revelation of the holiness of God, and in the light of that, they'd seen the enormity of their sin. God had so penetrated their minds and hearts that they had fallen to the ground. It wasn't trying to convince good man that he was in trouble with a bad God, but that it was to convince Batman that they deserved the wrath and anger of a good God.
Anything that you love more than you love Jesus Christ is an idol. Don't care what it is. I'm embarrassed to be part of the Church of Jesus Christ tonight, which is so totally, radically different from the New Testament. So impoverished, so blind, so powerless. I've come to this conclusion. There is a move of God in America today, but not amongst the unsaved. It's amongst the redeemed who are determined by the grace of God to be part of the bride. And to be part of the bride, you have to be divorced from everything in the world. We haven't witnessed to somebody who's going to an eternal hell according to our theology, but we talked about some tribute to them. Whisper in my ear that Satan has moved you up. He says you're getting to be dangerous to his kingdom. He says you're spoiling his plans. You're thwarting his purposes. You're pulling down his strongholds. We're not pulling things out. We're building pretty little churches and little rooms for people to sit around. If Jesus came back, he wouldn't cleanse the temple. He'd cleanse the pulpit. We're in grave danger when we let our accomplishments become the ground of our confidence. Oh boy, how we want to be esteemed, how we want to be respected, how people should realize what precious gifts of the Spirit I've given. You know why they don't? Because you stink with pride, that's why. Died in 1791, converted at 35, turn that round it makes 53, add them together it makes 88. Because he was saved at 35, preached for 53 years, and you know what he left when he died? He left a handful of books, a faded Geneva gown that he preached in all over England, 6 silver spoons somebody gave him, 6-pound notes, give one to each of the poor men that carry me to my grave. And that's all he left. 6-pound notes, 6 silver spoons, a handful of books, a Geneva gown, and something else. What was it, the other thing? Oh, I know something else he left. The Methodist Church. He could have died as rich as your famous TV preacher Sunday. Sure he made money, and he built orphanages. Sure he made money, he printed Bibles. Sure he made money, he compiled with Charles the Methodist hymn book. And look, those orphanages. And he died worth about $30. He printed Bibles, he printed hymn books, he financed missionaries to go across the earth. That's the way to use your money. You think of the reward. Why in God's name do you think it says don't lay up treasure on earth? Lay up treasure in heaven. I'm tired of writing about revival. I'm tired of reading about revival. There are more lost people in the world tonight than ever in the history of the world. And God wants some men who are really drunk, intoxicated with the Spirit of God, who have a love life with the Lord Jesus, that he can ask anything of you and he'll do it.
I have talked with people that have no assurance of sins forgiven. They want to feel saved before they're willing to commit themselves to Christ. But I believe that the only ones whom God actually witnesses by his Spirit are born of him are the people, whether they say it or not, that come to Jesus Christ and say something like this: Lord Jesus, I'm going to obey you and love you and serve you and do what you want me to do as long as I live, even if I go to hell at the end of the road, simply because you are worthy to be loved and obeyed and served, and I'm not trying to make a deal with you. But oh, I know so many people that are trying to know the fullness of God so that they can use God. A young preacher came to me down in West Virginia, Huntington, West Virginia. Brother Reed, I've got a great church. We've got a wonderful Sunday school program. We've got a radio ministry growing. But I feel a personal need and a personal lack. I need to be baptized with the Holy Ghost. I need to be filled with the Spirit. And someone told me God done something for you. And I wonder if you could help me. I looked at the fellow. You know what he looked like? Me. Just looked like me. I just saw in him everything that was in me. You thought I was going to say me before. No, listen, dear heart. If you've ever seen yourself, you'll know that you're never going to be anything else than you were. For in me, in my flesh, there's no good thing. Looked like me.
He's like a fellow driving up in a big Cadillac, you know, to someone standing at the filling station. Say, fill her up, bud, with the highest octane you got. Well, that's the way it looked. He wanted power for his program. And God is not going to be a means to anyone's end. I said, I'm awfully sorry. I don't think I can help you. He said, why? I don't think you're ready. I said, well, suppose you consider yourself coming up with a Cadillac. You've talked about your program. You've talked about your radio. You've talked about your Sunday school and church. It's very good. You've done wonderfully well without the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what the Chinese Christian said, you know, when he got back to China. What impressed you most about America? He said, the great things Americans can accomplish without God. And he'd accomplished a great deal, admittedly, without God. Now he wanted something, power, to accomplish his ends even further. I said, no. You're sitting behind the wheel and you're saying to God, give me power so I can go. You won't work. You've got to slide over. But I knew that rascal, because I knew me. I said, no, it'll never do. You got to get in the back seat. And I could see him leaning over and grabbing the wheel. No, I said, it'll never do in the back seat. I said, before God will do anything for you, you know what you've got to do? I said, he said, what? I said, you've got to get out of the car, take the keys around, open up the trunk lid, hand the keys to the Lord Jesus, get inside the trunk, slam the lid down, whisper through the keyhole, Lord, look, fill her up with anything you want, and you drive. It's up to you from now on. And that's why so many people, you know, do not enter into the fullness of Christ, because they want to become a Levite with 10 shekels and a shirt. They've been serving Micah, but they think if they had the power of the Holy Ghost, they could serve the tribe of Dan. It'll never work. Never work. There's only one reason for God meeting you, and that's to bring you to the place where, in repentance, you've been pardoned for his glory. And in victory, you've been brought to the place of death that he might reign. And in his fullness, Jesus Christ is able to live and walk in you. And your attitude is the attitude of the Lord himself, who said, I can do nothing of myself. I can't speak of myself. I don't make plans for myself. My only reason for being is the glory of God in Jesus Christ. If I were to say to you, come to be saved so you can go to heaven. Come to the cross so that you can have joy and victory. Come for the fullness of the Spirit so that you can be satisfied. I'd be falling into the trap of humanism. I'm going to say to you, dear friend, if you're out here without Christ, you come to Jesus Christ and serve him as long as you live, whether you go to hell at the end of the way, because he's worthy. I say to you, Christian friend, you come to the cross and join him in union and death and enter into all the meaning of death to hell in order that he can have glory. I say to you, dear Christian, if you do not know the fullness of the Holy Ghost, come and present your body a living sacrifice and let him fill you so that he can have the purpose for his coming fulfilled in you and get glory through your life. It's not what you're going to get out of God. It's what he is going to get out of you. Let's be done once and for all with utilitarian Christianity that makes God a means instead of the glorious end that he is. Let's resign. Let's tell Micah we're through. We're no longer going to be his priest serving for 10 shekels and a shirt. Let's tell the tribe of Dan we're through. And let's come and cast ourselves at the feet of the nail-pierced Son of God and tell him that we're going to obey him and love him and serve him as long as we live, because he is worthy. Two young Moravians heard of an island in the West Indies where an atheist British owner had 2,000 to 3,000 slaves. And the owner had said, no preacher, no clergyman will ever stay on this island. If he's shipwrecked, we'll keep him in a separate house until he has to leave. But he's never going to talk to any of us about God. I'm through with all that nonsense. 3,000 slaves from the jungles of Africa brought to an island in the Atlantic and there to live and die without hearing of Christ. Two young Moravians heard about it. They sold themselves to the British planter and used the money they received from the sale, for he paid no more than he would for any slave, to pay their passage out to his island, for he wouldn't even transport them. And as the ship left the river at Hamburg, left its pier in the river at Hamburg, and was going out into the North Sea carried with the tide, The Moravians had come from Hernhut to see these two lads off, nearly 20, never to return again, for this wasn't a four-year term. They'd sold themselves into lifetime slavery, simply that as slaves they could be as Christians, for these others were. The families were there weeping, for they knew they'd never see them again. And they wondered why they were going and questioned the wisdom of it. And as the gap widened and the houses had been cast off and were being curled up there on the pier, and the young boys saw the widening gap, one lad with his arm linked through the arm of his fellow raised his hand and shouted across the gap the last words that were heard from them. They were these. May the lamb that was slain receive the reward of his suffering. And this became the core of Moravian mission. And this is the only reason for being, that the lamb that was slain may receive the reward of his suffering.
And the question isn't where you're challenged, the question is where you're changed.
That was really good, wasn't it? Human. Amen. Humanism. We say it's all about God, but then we pull it right back. It's all about us. And we say, hey, Lord, what are you doing? God says, he keeps telling us it's not about you. It's not about you. It's not about you and your happiness. It's not about you. It's about me. And I did a sermon a few years ago about the glory of God. It's all about his glory. It's all about him. And yet, even though through all the preaching and that, there is this humanness that wants to attack us all the time and say, God, why are you doing it like this? Why are you doing it like that? Well, I already know that he's perfect. There's nothing wrong in him. He knows everything. We know very little. We don't even know. Compared to God, I don't know that we could even compare ourselves to an ant, us and an ant. You know, we look at an ant and say, well, you're really struggling there. Why don't I carry that leaf for you over here? You know? And we look at that and it's so humanistic. God, why am I suffering? God says, why not? All that you've done, all that you do, all that you think about, and you're wondering, why are you suffering? And it's really just all about him. What can I do for you, Lord? But then we complain what God is doing through us. Then we complain what God's doing to us when he's all righteous. There's no darkness in him. He's nothing but light. But yet we look at God and by looking at him, we're really looking at ourselves and saying, look how I'm hurting. Why don't you heal me? Where's your healing power at? Instead of looking at God and saying, you know what? You're perfect in every way. And I deserve every little bit I'm getting. I shouldn't even be asking you to heal me. But what can I do with what strength I have? What can I be doing for you, God? And he's right. We tell people, you don't want to go to hell. You want to be happy. You want to go to heaven. You want to be happy. And you know, a lot of people say, yeah, that sounds like a good deal. What do I need to do? Well, say it like this. Jesus is Lord. All right, Jesus is Lord. And I believe he rose on the third day. Well, brother, you're going to heaven. You're going to escape all that hell. And I have pointed out the phoniness of that prayer and the phoniness of that whole idea. I think a lot of people are going to die, go right to hell, and they're going to say, hey, I said that prayer. In 1975. But it was never about him. It's always about you. And so I'm going to read a few scriptures, and that it is about him, and how we're just kind of, we're left up to God to use us how he wants to use us, and how we shouldn't complain, because see, he's worthy. No matter what he's got us doing in life, we shouldn't be complaining. We should be just hard at what he wants us to do. He says, as it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. For thy sake, for his sake. He says, we are killed all the day long. This is in Romans 8:36. We are killed all the day long for his sake. You know what we'd say? What's up with that? Well, it says it's not about your life. It's about me. That's what God would say. It's not about your happiness. Get out of your depression. It's about me. Well, what are we so depressed about? Because it's about us. Right? Isn't that why a person's depressed? Because it's about them. And they don't like the way things are going. Rather than being about God and being free. My life is hid in Christ Jesus. What does that mean? Well, that's if I'm happy. As it is written, we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Why? For him. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors. And we say, how's that work? It's for him. Through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels or principalities or powers or things present or things to come, neither height nor depth or any creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. We are killed all the day long. I am convinced that nobody can separate me from the love of God. That same guy said, but we were killed all day long. And you would say, what's up with that? How do those things go together? However God decides to use you, he's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. We don't look at it like that. As long as I'm happy, then you're worthy. I'll boast in the Lord as long as I'm happy. God is good. He healed me. God is good. He set me free. Put a smile on my face. As long as I'm happy, I will give God praise. But if I'm not happy, he's going to catch it from me. But God says, but I'm worthy. But I'm worthy. The disciples got beat up. They got really talking to by the Sanhedrin. They got punched, poked, and said, don't you ever teach in the name of Jesus Christ. Well, they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. They suffered shame for the name of Jesus. They were found worthy to look like a shame before the church back in those days. They were found worthy. They said that they were counted worthy. They were rejoicing because they were counted worthy to suffer shame for him. Where's the us part in that whole thing about being happy, about being this? It wasn't that at all. They were rejoicing that they suffered shame. You ever feel like you're suffering a lot of shame for Jesus? That you did everything you're supposed to do and shame came upon you from other people? Not that you, as an evildoer, our suffering shame, but because of what you did, what was right in Christ, you did exactly what God wanted you to do, and you suffer shame. And this is what they did back then. They were rejoicing that they could look like fools for him, because that's what he wanted. He wanted them to suffer shame. Oh, God does want us to suffer shame, buddy. He wants us in a new Cadillac. No shame in that. You know, we always think God never wants us to suffer shame. Well, look at that family. All their children act like yahoos, whatever a yahoo is. A yahoo. And those parents still go to church, and they teach in the Sunday school, and they do everything they're supposed to be doing, and the whole, everybody says, but look at those children of theirs, how they live. And there's such a shame to them, but they're suffering shame for righteousness' sake. They never really look at their children. God is just doing what he's doing, and that you should count yourself joyful because you're suffering shame for what is right, and the eyes are all over you. You're a spectacle. So yeah, they still serve God, but those kids, and one day they said, hey God, you're righteous in everything that you do. You could save the world in a heartbeat if you wanted, but those children of mine went right to hell. Went right to hell. You know what we want? We always want happy endings. But we're suffering shame. And he's righteous in all his ways. For his glory. We were never in this whole thing for our glory. We were only in this thing for service to God. Never our glory. Looking like a spectacle if God so desires. Looking like a king if God so desires. It meant nothing to us, one way or the other. God says, this is what I have desired. Can't God do what he wants to do? He raises one from the dead and he leaves the other one dead. He heals one, he doesn't heal another one. Hasn't God showed us he's doing what he wants to do? But yet we want everybody healed. We want to show everybody the side of God. God says, I'm really not interested in that all the time. I want to show people that no matter what they do, they can't get healed, they die. And then I come in and I heal one. So Peter and the apostles said, we were found worthy to suffer shame, that people look on you and say, what scum of the earth you are. And they rejoice that they were found worthy to suffer shame. Look like complete morons. Paul was chosen to be a vessel, used as a vessel, and to suffer great things. Paul was. Hey, what's this suffering thing all about, God? What's this suffering thing all about? He says, for my glory. People see you and say, I can't believe he's going through what he's going through for this Jesus. Say, yeah. As he's there bleeding, whipped five times, as he's there bleeding, it's like, what a shameful thing. Because the people that are doing the beating are believing that they're right. The other people that are doing the beating on you believe that they're right. The eyes are looking on you and thinking you're a complete idiot, are doing it because they really believe you are an idiot. But you're following Jesus just the way that you're supposed to follow him. You ever notice, I want you to be able to see the difference between humanism and what is right, God getting the glory. Is when people are always complaining about their situation, them. Instead of I'm just here for the Lord. Well, you're hardly here. I am here. What little strength I have is left, I'm here for the Lord. Never give an excuse why I'm not here, I'm here. Why I'm always in acquiring in the temple of the Lord. Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I, but Christ that lives in me. What did he mean by that? That's what he meant. It's no longer me. Me's out of the way. Me is out of the way. He asked the Lord three times, take this thing away from me. He asked him three times. He didn't ask him 14,000 times like we do. Take this thing away and dwell on it, dwell on it. Yeah, yeah, hey God, you know, but things ain't working right inside my body. Things ain't working right. Things ain't working. God. Paul said three times, and he said, I didn't go to him anymore. And I just started focusing on God. With what I had going on, I just didn't deal with it anymore. I just dealt with what was before me with God. But what do? Because we're so into us. It's always, Lord, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? And we're consumed with us and our problem. Instead of dealing with, I've been here for God's glory, and I got something that's dogging me, and I guess that's the way it is, but I got to go on. Like the guy said, it really isn't about us and our happiness. It isn't about us and our happiness. Well, that's sure different, isn't it? In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21, I want you to see this. For hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps. What is his steps? That we should be suffering too. And the disciples got that and said, we're suffering shame. We are so glad that we are found worthy to look like idiots. Have you ever said that? Have you really thought that about your life? I thank you, God, that I look like a complete failure. A complete failure. For you. I thank you, God. And you actually rejoice in it. But you know what we do? God, where do you get glory out of me looking like a complete failure, numbskull, idiot, knucklehead? And must I say any more? Where do you get the glory out of this? Right? Because we got our idea about how we're going to change the world, how we're going to change things, right? Things always got to be on our standard instead of the standard of God. Do you think all these babies in the world, the millions and millions and millions have been aborted, that God wasn't able to stop all that, yet he let that go on? Holy is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Holy is the Lamb of God, for all things consist by him. His hand is in everything. He's holy. Leaving us example that we should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Who did no sin? He's never sinned. Jesus has never sinned. He never did sin. And when you say he is worthy, do we really understand what we're really saying? How worthy is he? Just that alone, you can't stop sinning. Your mind flies here, flies there, flies everywhere, and you got to say, oh God, forgive me. I dwelt on that too long. And God says, my mind has never gone there. Jesus says, my mind never went there. And what would you say? You are worthy to be bowed down to be served. Because I am such a sinner, I can't even control my mind. You are worthy. God says, not only that, I am all-knowing. I am all-powerful. I know everything that ever is going to happen, ever did happen, and ever will happen. I know everything. And you would look at that and you go,
Besides that other, you are worthy on that one too. I made everything, the hand, the planets exist. I stretched out the yardstick and I measured the heavens and put it all in motion. And you go, besides you knowing everything, just you doing that. Oh my Lord, you are worthy. And we think of all the times that God is worthy. Look how you made a human being, fearfully and wonderfully made. As we look at things, we say, oh my golly, that is marvelous. Oh Lord, you are worthy. How many times is he worthy? Have we ever thought, oh Lord, you are worthy? And we go, yeah, he's worthy. And it just kind of slides over, skims over us like a scum pond in our mind, you know, like, And we don't really even think about how worthy he is. He always was. Stop right there. Wouldn't that be good enough to be, you are worthy? Let alone, you'll always be. Isn't that good enough to say, you are worthy of my praise, of my service? Why? Well, you're never going to die. You're never going to die. And not only that, you're God. In a light of all that, you're worthy. Right? Am I looking at this thing wrong or am I looking at this thing right? You put up with me. I can't hardly put up with myself. But you, being perfect, seeing all things, knowing all things about me, everything that I'm going to do. And yet one day I say, oh God, thank you that I am righteous. And the next day I'm on my face in shame, asking for mercy, asking for forgiveness. And that you knew that yesterday and you loved me then. God, you are worthy. You are worthy. You are worthy of my service today. You are worthy of my praise. You are worthy of saying, thank you, God, that you haven't trashed me already. So when you think about how worthy he is, for as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind, for he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. When you start suffering, not trying to avoid, when you start being shamed, because that's just the way God, you know, we run from things that we see coming, and God says, what are you running for? Well, that I see shame coming. I'm running from that. I'm running from it. God says, I don't want you to run from it. I want you to go through this thing with me. This is for my sake, for my name's sake, not for yours. Yeah, but that ain't how I do stuff here on earth, God. God says, that's how I do stuff in heaven. On earth as it is in heaven, that is how I want the show to run. When you see things a certain way in your life and you've served the Lord, and you know you've tried to change some things and it just doesn't change, then you just got to say, is God not able to change it? I serve the Lord and I walk with God. I guess if he wanted to be changed, it would be changed. It would be that simple. I've lifted up my request to him and he hasn't changed it. So I thank God in my embarrassment. I thank God in my embarrassment and I refuse to be griping to God and refuse to be depressed over the thing. I will be joyful and happy because this is what he has decided for me. So I have ceased from sin, and I want you to see this. Let me read this again. I'm going to change one word in it. For as much then, this is 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1. For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind, for he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from self. He that suffers in the flesh for Christ has ceased from self. Because we're always trying to get out of it.
And many times not doing the will of God and taking the easy road. And God says, I didn't want you to take that road. I didn't want you to take that road. For he, verse 2, for that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men. And what's the lust of men? Always to have it big, easy, and great in their eyes. That's lust of men. But to the will of God. Ah, that's the key, to the will of God. Well, God always wants everything to be bigger, better, does he? You ever seen a righteous person in an old jalopy with no jalopy, with nothing but the clothes they have on them? You suppose there's a righteous person anywhere like that that serves God? And how many times do we hear the thing being preached? So much different than that. Claiming they got 40,000 souls saved. How did you get them saved? Well, I told them they had heaven to gain and hell to shun. Well, even Jesus himself said, fear God, fear the one that can destroy both soul and body in hell, can kill you and destroy you in hell. Oh, but really, isn't it all about God? He's worthy to glorify his name. But the God of all grace, who has called us unto his eternal glory through Christ Jesus, that after you suffer a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. What does the suffering do? It causes you to see in a new light the way of the Lord. The way of the Lord. It settles you down into the way that you need to go. Didn't say it changed the situation. The suffering for a while causes you to be sober and say, what's going on, God? And God says, I've been waiting for that question for 25 years. This is what's going on. This is what I want for you. God makes one man poor, another one rich. Is God unrighteous? No, he's perfect. In that, he's worthy. God makes one man sick and worships him, and another man well and worships him. Is God unrighteous, or is he perfect? There is no darkness in God, right? Hasn't there been Christians that had complete health, right? He has Christians that have hardly no health. We've seen Christians live for a long time with perfect health, and Christians die early with bad health. Both went to heaven. Where is their darkness? Where is their sinfulness in God in the whole thing? Nothing. He got the glory out of both. We had a school teacher here. She was my Sunday school teacher. She was in a wheelchair to the day she died. She was hoping God for her healing, but she worshiped God and praised God. A lot of people would have got up and said, I'm in a wheelchair. I'm not serving no God like that. But she did. Who got the best glory out of that? God got the glory out of, from that woman, and said she always was with the Lord. No matter what came her way, she was with the Lord. Her husband left her for another woman because he had had enough of that. Took off. She stayed with the Lord. You hearing me? Who got the glory? God got the glory. Did she suffer shame? She sure did. Everybody saw around town that the man was with somebody else's woman and not his own woman. Who got the glory out of the whole thing? She suffered shame and said she still stayed with God. God's ways are not your ways. It's all about him. And Jesus gives us a couple clues here, and I'll only go on for a couple more minutes. He that loveth father and mother, or brother or sister more than me, he gives us a standard right there. If you love anything let alone yourself, more than me. But that's my son. God says, but I'm God. Are you not bought with a price? Well, that's a nice cliche. No, that's a nice truth, God says. I have bought you. You're mine. I didn't buy your daughter. Am I unrighteous for that? I heard your request, but I didn't answer it. Am I unholy for that? Or do we fall on our face and say, blessed be the name of the Lord forever? Whatever you have decided, you have done. There is no unrighteousness. There is no darkness. There is nothing wrong with my God. The only possibility of any wrong could be is me. But God, that don't make me happy. That don't make me happy. I know. But what I decide is still perfect. I may yield to your requests and grant it to you, or I may not. I am God. You're worthy, my Lord. You're worthy. You know what? One day Satan's going to say that. It says, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that he is worthy, he is Lord. Satan will be doing that too, knowing that he's going to go in the flames of fire and the lake of fire forever and all his angels with him. That's why it was made. He's going to be doing the same thing. Why don't we just get a clue now and do it before he does it? Amen? And get off our attitude. And they love not their lives even unto death. This is in Revelations, and we know the scripture. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. But notice this one thing about that, what gave them real power. They didn't love their life even unto death. It was spent, it was for the glory of God. Crucify me if you want to crucify me. Kill me. Put your sword through me, cut my head off, whatever. For my life is to glorify God. I still see those, what ISIS did a few months ago and cut the heads off those guys. They are all lined up. That gave God glory. Forgive me, Jesus, for what I've done as their necks are being cut off. I thank you, God, that I can be your sacrifice today. Is that what we would say? Or what would we be saying? You'll know in a moment like that what is really in you, you'll be saying. No, 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 no. Or, blessed be the name of the Lord. I am leaving this world now. I have fought a good fight. I have ran that race. Now my life is being offered up as a ransom. Is that what we would say? I hope. I hope that's what's buried deep down into our hearts. And I, like you, have asked why. Why this, why that? We might as well just quit asking. We might as well just stop. If God be merciful, us and all our families will be in heaven. Has there ever a mother and a father get into heaven that were good Christians, they didn't find all their kids there? Was there ever kids there that their mom and dads didn't make it? And I'm going to tell you, yes, I know. I know that that has happened. How should we live our lives right now? Complete service and complete honor to God. And we have to figure out what that really means and what that is. But he is worthy of it. And God's in complete control of our life if we just give our life to him and say, whatever, I will suffer shame for you, God. That's what you want me to do, so be it. Not about me being happy, and it's not about me. It's about you. Hallelujah. And those, that preacher that you heard, those are some long ago preachers. We want that old time religion brought back. We are inundated today with music that is full of sexualism. Singing to Jesus like he's some sexual lover from these singers. And I have seen it in music and I go, he is not your sexual lover. He is God. Let's sing with a little bit of respect. But all the moods and the emotions in it, that's where our church has gone today. It's an abomination to him. Really, it is an abomination to him. Not all of it. There's a lot of good. God help us to sort the difference. Not only sort other people's music, but sort ourself out too. Amen. So you know what? I'm going to stop being down about this and that. It's obvious this is what God's doing in my life. I'm going to just serve him and get happy about it and say, my life is a sacrifice to you, God. Give me strength, Lord, to follow you. Amen.